where we see teachers adopting electronic textbooks are not in the literacy area. We see them not in English language arts. We see it in issues like math and science and history. Okay? Here are some of the benefits that they see in terms of those things. One is expanded content. Okay? What I mean by that is these books allow for embedded videos. They allow for you to easily jump off into additional websites. They allow for you to have definitions of terms simply by putting the cursor over the term, okay? So that idea of expanded content is a plus. And quite frankly, that's why we actually see it adopted more in content areas and less in literature areas, because we could make the argument that those same things that enhance content knowledge might actually be distracting to overall comprehension of the narrative. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay? So, we see this in terms of expanded content as being a major plus, all right? The other, which is kind of related, is these books allow for you to integrate assistive technology that is aimed at supporting particular types of learners much more feasibly than what you can do in a paper copy. So many e-readers that are being produced, particularly for K-12 settings, have the functionality of being able to read the text out loud, all right? So if you have a student who is struggling with their reading fluency or their decoding, or even has English as a second language, you can see how that functionality of being able to hear the text in addition to seeing the text would be worthwhile. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. Now, some challenges with that. So those are huge pluses. Some challenges with that. Some of those things are just kind of things that people didn't anticipate. Here's one. Communicating with parents about progress in reading, okay, or even in the content. How much of what the student is doing are they able to do independently versus how much is the student using all these additional features to quote-unquote hack their learning, right? Okay. Now, you could make the argument, does it matter if they're doing all these things as long as they're learning the content area? But we have to remember that the goals in K-12 is not just for students to learn the content. It's for them to learn to read in that content area. Does that make sense for everybody? So that's an issue that people are grappling with.
Can you repeat that again?
Yeah, so I'll say it a different way, okay? So for example, imagine that I'm a history teacher and I'm using an enhanced ebook to teach with, right? And part of what I want to do to communicate with parents, let's say I'm a sixth grade history teacher, so not seventh or eighth grade, I'm still in that elementary kind of continuum. What I want to be able to do is understand not just, is this kid learning history from me, but is this kid learning about reading history too? And as a teacher, if I'm using a book with all these bells and whistles, do I know whether the student is just using all those adaptive things in order to get the content? Or do I know if I gave the student a very traditional piece of writing in history, would they be able to understand it? Do you see what I'm saying, right? So while this assistive technology and expanded content is a plus, it can also be a minus in terms of question marks about how much autonomy are we taking away from the learner, and how much should we expect the learner to bring to the act of reading? That's a good mind-bender if you can come to think about that one. Huge, okay? So that's an interesting thing to think about. The other thing to think about is just in terms of construction. Right now, the people that are constructing these books aren't necessarily people that know a lot about teaching and learning. They're people that know a lot about technology, right? And so what happens when you open up a social studies textbook in fifth or sixth right now. You're kind of assaulted with information overload. One of the question marks is, how will we as a society learn as educators to think about what content is essential for that child to have? How much of it is important that we really direct them to, and how much of it is just noise? Do you follow me on that? Okay. It's a little bit like when you take a book that's all jacked up and enabled with all of this stuff, if we aren't careful, it's a little bit like taking a five-year-old to the doors of a library and saying, like, let's picture a really big one, like the New York City Library, and push in, and they enter the library and say, have fun, here you go. And we don't give them any guidance, right? So the implication for us as teachers is that as this medium increases, we have to be thoughtful not just about helping our students to know how to comprehend that text information, but how to make decisions about how they seek more information when needed, and how to refrain from seeking more information when it can be a distraction. Does that make sense to everybody? It's a little bit like your life right now, right? You've got files moving, right? You're doing all these projects. So you have this problem, probably, where as you're doing projects, you're utilizing a lot of electronic resources to get them done, and you have the whole World Wide Web at your fingertips. And chances are, the ability as a learner to say, no, that's just, I don't need to know what kind of Christmas cookie I am. I will not take that. Okay, right? Versus, I have to focus on these sources, these things. Yes, I have to know what kind of Christmas cookie you are. Accurate, right? So is it hard for you as an adult learner who's pretty highly motivated? Imagine the type of digital behaviors we may have to start teaching children at a very young age to learn not just how to navigate the text information, but how to navigate all the extraneous information that will be bundled with their text. That's a fascinating thing to think about, right? Is your mind blown yet? Okay. All right, questions or comments about this so far? Yes.
I know my sister's high school this year actually just transitioned to completely on Chromebooks. So everything they do, their homework, their essays, their textbooks, everything on their personal Chromebook. And it's kind of nice just because she doesn't have to look for papers. She doesn't have to figure out what things are. It's very organized, and she's not an organized person, so it helps. But the school, even though they put blocks on like Facebook, they know how to get around it. It's very hard to keep them focused in class. My mom is
especially if you're a very traditional teacher. You know, my boys have a teacher right now who I love the guy, but he's not winning any awards for super engagement because he's very traditional. And honestly, if my kids had their fingertips on something in his class, they'd be gone. They would be gone. You know, it doesn't mean he's a bad teacher. It means that you have to be thoughtful about the distraction the kids have in class. Other comments on this issue?
This is like me, it seems very individualized. Like, I feel like a textbook is very easy to see what your kid is doing. You can look over their shoulder, see what's going on. There's like, I don't know.
No, it's hard.
Having that technology, you're just putting, I feel like, that's a good thing, giving a student a very active role in their learning.
Yeah.
But
how do you direct them to the common purposes of what you want to
and
do?
How do you can, I guess, formally assess them during class, like, to keep them with you, which, like, yes, is something that you have to do with that.
Yeah.
Because if you didn't, it would be so easy for
it
them to go
so
on
and easy
app.
For them to just be gone,
yeah.
Right? Think about it at home with the homework for a moment, right? You know, so like on the one hand, you could say, all right, so that's really easy for the kids to stay organized, all of those good things, but how much are they doing what you actually ask them to do versus running off into other directions? And it's not even necessarily that the directions they're going to are bad. It's just that, are they purposeful for what you wanted them to learn? I'll give another example from the boys. And the other interesting thing is, as teachers, I have to tell you, whether we adopt the technology or not, the kids have it, right? So my example is not a teacher who's using the electronic book. It's my kids at home who are using electronics to help them finish their homework, all right? So Ben and Gabe, you have to understand, I love all their teachers. I really do. But they had an assignment from social studies, and she is a tremendous, tremendous teacher. They love her. But this assignment was kind of a very low-level assignment, and her goal with the assignment was for them to learn to use an atlas, very specific tool. She wanted them to learn things about looking things up in the atlas. All right, that was her goal. As a parent, I know that from reading the assignment. Most parents wouldn't know that. They would just think the goal is to finish the page. So the assignment was there were all these obscure countries labeled, and you needed to find a city within each obscure country. So the teacher fully expected them to leaf through the atlas and to find the countries on the world map and find a city. Okay, you are already rolling your eyes because you think, I don't even do that, right? What do you think Ben and Gabe did? With what? Their phones. They sat there with their phones and they just asked Google, okay, Google, what's a city in Luxembourg? Okay, Google, what is, you know, what is. So they got done with this paper really quickly. Now, if I were a better mother, I'd probably go, like, use the atlas. So instead, I made them go on to Google Earth and actually fly to the cities. And afterwards, I said, got done with it quick. You think you're so clever, don't you? Now, I could make the argument that they probably had a richer experience with that than looking in the atlas because that extra added thing. But my point is, if their goal was to learn an atlas, how to navigate that as a resource, they didn't get it. No, I know. That's why I didn't care. Because I thought they're never going to freaking use the atlas. I heard you curse. No, they're never going to do it.
It sounds like you feel the same way about teaching dictionaries and stuff like that.
Well, the dictionary, honestly, when was the last time any of you cracked open a dictionary? So this challenge for us as teachers is they're going to do it anyhow. They're going to, all right? You already do, right? But the challenge is if we can see you're adult learners, and Ben and Gabe are actually pretty capable, self-motivated learners. If we can rewind that to a very early literacy piece, we need to think about not just the idea of how are they learning to read, but maybe a bigger title of how are they learning to navigate information is a really, really big issue with this. Okay? Fascinating stuff. Do you like our trend discussion so far? A gallop along, okay? All right, you ready for the second one? All right, I've kind of infringed on my space here. The second one is one that should be very near and dear to many of you. Okay. The second trend that we are seeing in the research is an explosion of interest in what we can do to help improve the literacy outcomes for those individuals with low incidence disabilities. All right? The old paradigm for this cohort group was that the most that we could expect was to teach them some functional sight words and some very rudimentary writing skills. All right? But we are beginning to rethink that for several reasons. One reason is that for many of these individuals who have whatever constellation of needs they have that causes them to have difficulty communicating, whether that's verbal communication or nonverbal communication, those kinds of things, the explosion in assistive technology, storyboards, those kinds of things, means that this having access to an ability to express themselves in ways and manners that just even 10 years ago would have just been a dream, right? So I'll take an example of a very dear friend of mine whose daughter is has a severe label of very challenged autism. She's nonverbal, right? When she was a young child, the only way she could communicate with her family was through picture cards that were on cardstock. That was the only way that she could do it. It was a laminated poster. And she had a very limited vocabulary at her disposal, right? When, you know, people started developing applications and more software, you saw the growth of assisted speaking devices, but those things were incredibly expensive and they were not really accessible to most people. They were just for a few people that had access to them. What do you see now? Would she communicate? What do you think? Do you think she communicates with a poster that's laminated? What do you think she uses to communicate with her family? She uses something like a Dynavox, but it's actually an app on an iPad, okay, and I think it's called ProLogo or something like that. It's an app that somebody created, and it costs $2, okay? And the family has the ability to add more words to it by taking their own photographs and adding that to the corpus of words that she can use to communicate. It's a game changer for her in terms of her ability to communicate. What do you know about language skills? If you improve one language area, it leads to improvement in the other language areas, right? So with more of a robust way of communicating, what we've seen trend-wise is that we're finding that when you compare those picture cues with actual text, it's actually leading to an increase in literacy. Not dramatic levels of increases yet, but far beyond what we commonly expected. So if we can get past this small group of sight words, now these are words that are meaningful to the student. You're able to easily combine them with the picture cues. The student has an ability to not just communicate verbally through the application, but through writing too. That's really fascinating. And because of that, it's making us question our notions of what we should be teaching these children from an earlier age. Maybe we shouldn't just be focusing on this small, narrow group of sight words. Maybe we should be taking an interesting emergent literacy perspective with them by using adaptive technology to see very individualized where we can grow them in their literacy abilities. Does that make sense to everybody? It's a whole new world, really, when it comes to that. What we see the emphasis in this area is this idea of the marriage of very rich visual mediums or oral mediums, if it's a student who has visual impairment, combined with assistive technology. Okay, so very, very interesting stuff. Questions or comments about that? Here's another prediction, okay? So when you think about this, does this make sense to you, by the way? Like, is it like, or am I still like on? Okay, all right, you're with me on this? Think about some children that you've seen, right? And that you've worked with. And think about how with an increase in technology that allows them to communicate, you might be able to improve their literacy outcomes. Does that make sense for everybody? Okay, nodding heads. So here's the interesting thing about this. People still say, well, that could work for this student or that could work for this student because, you know, these students have the physical skills to be able to push things. What if in the future, our ability to choose how we communicate isn't so much by push, but through other gestures, all right? Stephen Hawking, I may have mentioned him in class the other day, he made all kinds of news in the literacy world a few weeks ago because Intel designed a whole new program for him to be able to communicate. If you don't know who Stephen Hawking is, movies are coming out this Christmas about the guy, okay? Smart guy, okay? Not that smart, I guess. But anyhow, really smart in the area of science, all right? But has ALS syndrome, very significant physical challenges. Now you can say, well, that was a disability that impeded over time. However, think about if we're able to harness how people communicate, this new technology designed by Intel, do you know what he uses to pick out the words he wants to use? Just his cheek, just one muscle in his cheek. That's it. If we can design something so that an individual can write scientific papers that get lauded the world over, by just using the muscles in his cheek, how can we backwards engineer that so that individuals that we previously thought could not read, write, communicate at all, any of those language areas, how can we start thinking from a developmental view of how to integrate that assistive technology? That's a fascinating thing. I don't know enough about that to predict where that is going. All I can tell you is that all the research points out that in this area, strong collaborations between those that design the technology and strong collaborations between people that have the best teaching methods at their disposal will be necessary in order to bring about this change. It's going to be a fascinating thing, a really, really fascinating thing. Questions or comments about that one? No? I'll just let that float out there. Okay. Ready for turn three? Are you having fun yet today?
I'm having all kinds of fun.
Okay. This one's a little bit related to the issue we were talking about at first. The concept of multi-literacy. Okay?
That took me a while.
I know, and I'm not making it up. It would be fun. When they're April Fools, it would be fun just to spout off nonsense for a while. Watch everybody get confused and then say, I'm kidding. Maybe I'll do that for kicks and giggles with my class next semester.
Something to do with sensory or multi or differentiated learning.
Yeah, just come up with crazy terms and watch everybody sweat. I remember when you had this in Ed Psych.
Oh my God.
I digress! Can we talk about multi-literacies for a minute? Multi-literacies refers to this concept that where we get our information from comes across multiple platforms. Multiple platforms, okay? I love telling the stories about Ben when I think about multi-literacy because he is my kid that is, he fits this notion perfectly. When Ben wants to learn a subject, he is not content to learn that subject across one or two platforms. He wants to take a deep dive with it across every kind of medium he can get his hands on, all right? Right now, maybe I told you this story, but right now, Ben goes to gymnastics every Monday. And on the way home from gymnastics, it's in Cranberry, so it's a long drive. We listen to The Odyssey by Homer, right? Not some watered-down version. We listen to the real stuff, okay? And, what's interesting is that Ben, you would think, wow, that's going to challenge that sixth grader to listen to, like, that old-fashioned language and all of those things and all these Greek names and everything else. But he does this funky stuff when he's learning something new. He connects it across so many platforms. So he has the books by Rick Riordan as his background knowledge in this area. So everything goes through the lens of how did Percy Jackson interact with that. And then on top of that, for fun, Ben has this this habit of finding wacky YouTube videos that are actually funny that have to do with these various topics. And then he likes looking at images of things, so when a monster is mentioned, he's not content to listen to the author's description, even if it's Homer, it's not good enough for him. He has to look online and he has to look at different pictures of how other artists have represented that figure, okay? And then he likes to write about it himself in any opportunity that he can, all right? That is a prime example of multi-literacy. You see that? It's this idea that instead of just engaging with one type of literacy source for learning a topic, learners of tomorrow will pool together all this mosaic of information in order to learn about the topic, right? Let me take another example. Right, one that's a little bit more lighthearted. Ben, I thought at one point, you know, like who knows what he'll do in the future, but he likes coming up with stories and he's very visual. So I thought, well, maybe the kid will be interested in film in the future. So I got him one of these big coffee table books about Steven, who was the director of Spielberg. Okay, so I have a huge coffee table book for him. Never expected him to do more than look at the pictures in the thing, okay? Because it's not written for kids, it's written for people who are really into film. So one night I'm tucking him into bed and he's laughing and laughing at a YouTube parody of Jaws. And he's laughing at all the right moments and I have not allowed him to see this bloody movie. So I'm thinking, how does he know? I said, Ben, how do you even know that this is funny? Like, why, how do you, you know, because he's laughing at stuff that only someone who's seen the movie would typically get. And he said, well, I read that book you gave me about Steven Spielberg, so there's the literacy piece. I knew I wasn't allowed to watch the movie, so I watched the trailer. And then I read Wikipedia about the movie because I knew I wasn't allowed to watch the movie. And then when I looked at the YouTube video of the cartoon version of Jaws, it was really funny. Multi-literacy, okay? Are you following me on that? Okay. One more, because I can't resist and I have time. A few years ago, we're in Disney World. I take them to see the Mickey's Phil whatever show at Universal Studios, where at the end, Steamboat Willie comes out on a steamboat, this lovely moment. And me, because I'm a teaching nut, I can't resist the teachable moment, so we're walking back to the transportation. I said, you know, Steamboat Willie was the very first cartoon that Walt Disney made. It's what made him famous. And in the little cartoon, it was just like that. It was black and white. A few minutes later, I'm putting the kids to bed. He won't go to bed. He's laughing. He's playing with his electronic device. And go to bed. Walt Disney was really clever with Steamboat Willie. He was the cow. It was so funny. Then what are you doing? Oh, I decided I wanted to watch it. Okay, so he went on to YouTube and he found the original Steamboat Willie and decided to supplement his viewing experience with more viewing. Multi-literacy, okay? All right, here's my overall point. My point is that right now what we have in schools is a situation where we have some children like him that are like doing that on their own. But the implication for us as teachers is that maybe we need to think about delivering instruction in a way that helps students to be curious and thoughtful about doing that themselves. Instead of just taking it for granted that they will do it, the teaching point here is how do we teach literacy in a way that encourages them to do that, but encourages them to do it in a way that fits our instructional purposes instead of just dancing cats. You know, that's out there too. You know, so we don't know yet what it is in those learners. We talk about reader habits and teacher habits. We don't know what the multi-literacy your habits yet, what are their unique strengths that allow them to do it well? And if we can identify that, then we'll know the teaching strategies to give to everybody so that they'll be more inclined to do it well. Does that make sense? Okay. Yes.
What about students who can't look up things on their platform?
Well, and that's interesting too. I just read an article in Forbes Business Magazine, and I only started it, so I didn't finish it, about Mark Zuckerberg right now. If you don't know him, he owns your soul. He's in charge of Facebook, right? Okay, but like, he has this mission to make everyone worldwide have access to the internet, okay? And it's not a business thing with him. You would think, oh my gosh, how much money do you need, Mark Zuckerberg? Really? You know, but his mission is not really about the bottom line. It's more about individual empowerment, you know? So that's kind of fascinating. So we're seeing this movement where right now that's a concern we have in 2014 of like, what about the haves and have-nots when it comes to all of this constellation of stuff? All the predictions are that won't be an issue. Like back in the Middle Ages, the issue was who has access to print, right? What came along with printing press? So we don't know what the thing is that's coming along, but it's coming, you know, fascinating stuff. Don't you live in a neat spot? Okay, so we only have 2 minutes. All right, that's enough time. Have I given you enough that I can rob you of 2 minutes of tuition time? Very good.